imagine for a moment that you are in your own country, coming here to Kadavisam, and you see a board like this. That these premises are only used by a certain category of people. And unfortunately, that category is decided by color of your skin, that you don't have any control about. A week before, we discussed about freedom of our country, the happiness, the excitement, the sacrifice that went with it. And we became free, independent nation in 1947. We discussed last week, 1950, we became republic, democratic, we rule ourselves. In the same year, same time, 1948, South Africa, country in the Africa continent, got a new government, and there started a period of pain. It didn't last for a short while. From 1949 to 1990, for a very long period, the country suffered a law passed by the ruling party, racial segregation of people, which meant that whites and all others had to use different facilities. They cannot live together, they cannot work together. If they work, they are treated separately. They did not have voting rights. They did not have their own farms. Not for 1 year, not for 2 years. Britishers ruled us for 150 years. It went for 40 years by their own people, just that they were white. Imagine the situation that you cannot live as a normal citizen in your own motherland. A lot of people revolted, and there was one person well known to a lot of folks. But what happened? In some places, African National Congress revolted. In some places, Zulu people revolted. It went to such a cringing levels that in 1976, children, colored children, were asked to study in Afrikaans, a language that they did not know. Afrikaans is a language originated from Dutch, who were the original settlers to this place. Children revolted that we want to study in our own mother tongue, or maybe in English, which they were trying to struggle with. They were fired at. School children were fired at. And this photo became a trigger point for the world to understand the gravity of apartheid. An 18-year boy carrying a 13-year boy hopelessly thinking he will survive, and he didn't. It didn't end there. The photographer, the savior, were persecuted. They had to flee the country to the point that they were never seen again. They lived in depression. In such depressing situation, one person fought alone. But where? In exile, in a jail. 27 years. At his age 44, he was imprisoned. And he was released when he was 72. Imagine yourself, whatever your age may be, 27 years of your life, you live in a jail, hoping that one day you will come out, one day things will change, and it did. How long is the period? How difficult is the place? For 18 years, he lived in a prison called Robben Island, in a cell which is smaller than this place. Smaller than where I'm standing, for 18 years. What would a person do when he gets released from such a prison and gets to be the next president? In a normal world that we have seen for the last 20, 30 years, first thing will be he will gather all the opposition and kill them en masse. Saddam Hussein. why a political situation, why countries, a new CEO comes, the next layer is gone in a month. Why go far away? What he did, he said, no, I want to be leader of a nation, what they termed as a rainbow nation, where everybody comes together as a rainbow. They adopted an anthem which comprised of 5 languages representing the various ethnic people in the country. It didn't end there. Here comes one more small twist which I want to share, which I searched about through a movie. So the white people had their own rugby team called Springbok. The name comes, comes from a gazelle, an antelope in the region. So it was their emblem. The black people hated it because they considered it is Afrikaans game. We don't like it. They hated it to the point that they would cheer any team up fighting against the Springbok. When Mandela came back as a president, he decided to retain Springbok with their emblem, with their colors. In 1995, a year after he took presidency, he hosted Rugby World Cup. Thankfully, with the help of one white man who resonated his beliefs, Francois Pina, captain of the team, they went to public places, they went to black ghettos to promote the team. They got African people into the team, and slowly those who were hating it started supporting it. With his determination, with his magnanimity, with his generosity, he got that connect with white people, and they started believing in the black population through him. It didn't end there. It culminated to the greatest surprise of the century. The team, which was not even expected to reach quarterfinals, reached finals through their sheer determination. And that day he surprised the people by walking on to the crown in the colors of Springbok, wearing their cap. And the crowd, 62,000 people of combined races, surprised him by singing the new national anthem together. Gives me goosebumps to think that those who were ready to kill each other, in a matter of couple of years, he managed to unite them. Sport has an uncanny ability to get people together. They were pitted against the best of the lot, All Blacks New Zealand. One of the best team ever. In the previous match, they had created international record for score against any team, and they went ahead to beat them just by one goal. You can see Nelson Mandela handing over the trophy to Francois. What I really thought about this, this is unbelievable, this is extraordinary because of his thought. He says that, I don't believe about a domination of one race against the other, but it is all about living together in the hope of having a democratic society. And years before, in 64, when he was jailed, he said, I hope to live for it, and it is the ideal I'm ready to die for. The last point which I want to just touch upon and leave you pondering over, what gives somebody this kind of big heart, magnanimity, and tremendous ability to sustain those 27 years. It seems he believed in this poem, Invictus, which he shared with Francois, which helped him through these 27 years and years after. I'll leave you with the last line. He says, it matters now how straight the gate, how charged with punishments the scroll. I am the master of my fate, I am the captain of my soul.